So we're going to be talking about Monroe Edwards. He is a real person who is a forgotten figure in Texas history. His parents, he is a direct descendant of the family that funded Stephen F. Austin's trip to Mexico so that he could buy his father's grants from the Mexican government and then settle Texas. He also grew up in New Orleans, where he was apprentice of James Morgan, who was the commander of the Texas Navy during the Texas Revolution. Monroe was really set up to become kind of a Texas hero, like you think of William B. Travis, who he was actually best friends with, or Stephen F. Austin or Sam Houston or any of those names. But instead of doing that, he actually did end up becoming the most celebrated slaver in Texas history, and one of its most celebrated criminal slavers during the time of the Penny Dreadfuls, those magazines that were kind of like a precursor to the National Enquirer. They used to write these big stories about criminals, and Monroe was a big one like that. We're going to focus not so much on the criminal activity, but on what made him in a position where he could do that. We're going to look at the years that he was probably, according to most academics, the only Texas slaver who went straight to Africa and came back. So we're going to study or look at that period of time when Texas actually had a direct link to the West African slave trade. I'm supposed to do this myself, right? There I go. Okay. So we'll be chronicling his trip to Lomboko. Lomboko is a slave fortress that will be known to most of you who may have seen the movie Amistad. At the end of Amistad, the British Navy comes up to the coast of Africa and starts blowing up a fortress. That was Lomboko. It was in the Galenas, off the coast near Sierra Leone, and its fortress was made specifically for one reason and one reason only. It was built to provide the Cuban market with slaves. And that's the only thing it did. We're going to start 7 years before the Texas Revolution, when Monroe went to it. He went to it because of a friend that he knew named Holcroft. Holcroft asked him to go with him on a slave run, and he said okay. Now, in the mid-1800s, 1830s, Britain was really leading the moral conflict and economic conflict between pro-slavery and anti-slavery. They had started passing legislation probably 10 years earlier to try to outlaw slavery, but there were still a lot of loopholes that were exploited, and these were the loopholes that Monroe and Holcroft and the guys were working through. So this is a map from the New York Digital Library, and it shows, what I like about it is because it's one of the very few maps I have found that actually show Galveston, Texas as being part of the slave smuggling route, because it was. Abolitionists knew this, and they were very much watching Texas and expecting Texas to become the new market for slaves during the 1820s and 1830s. They knew that Texas was going to be fighting Mexico at some point for its independence, and they absolutely expected Texas to win. They expected after that time, Texas was going to become a major player on the transatlantic slave route. Mexican had actually outlawed slavery, and they did not allow slavery when Stephen F. Austin was settling with his old 300. But they overlooked it. And the reason they overlooked that Austin was allowing people to come in is because they could not get their own residents and citizens interested in settling Texas. So they had to bring in immigrants. And those immigrants were the United States. So slavery was always a tension of conflict. And it was never something that Mexico and Stephen F. Austin ever really got along with. But as you know, After the revolution, Texas did immediately make Texas a slave country, and not only did they make it a slave country, but they stripped all the people, free people of color, of their citizenship too, told them they had 18 months to leave, or they would be sold on the auction block as well. So the possibility of Texas as a slave nation. Texas was smack in the global spotlight as the possible slave nation. British, there were two sets of people in Britain at the time. There were the abolitionists who were controlling the politics, but there were also the banks and the merchants. The banks and the merchants wanted slavery. They wanted slavery, they were funding it. I'm gonna show you how. The merchants wanted it because they wanted Texas to be a cash crop. And Cape Palmas, which is where one of the abolitionist colonies were on the West Coast, you can see here that in the 1830s, they were writing what they knew about Texas, and this is exactly what they said about Texas. They knew that agents from Texas were going to be showing up on the West African coast to purchase slaves. And the year that they wrote this was the same year that Monroe Edwards showed up on the shores. So let's look at Monroe. Who was he? As Tom has told you, he's a very interesting character. He was born in Kentucky. He went to New Orleans, where he was an apprentice of James Morgan when James Morgan was still running his very, very profitable mercantile industry and network in New Orleans. While he was in New Orleans, I believe that he watched Lafitte. He watched how Jean Lafitte would capture slave ships and make money off of it. And so this is how Lafitte was doing it. There were so many loopholes. There were so many ways that you could get around it if you were smart enough to figure out that you could end up making money on slaves twice. And this is how. Lafitte would go out. He would capture a slave ship. Now, a slave ship didn't just have slaves on it. A lot of times it had a lot of other things on it. It had maybe spices and things like that. Well, you bring the slave ship in, you take it to the customs collector. The customs collector pays you for bringing in this loot. At that point, the government allowed the customs collector to get some money back for the effort he put in to accepting all these goods, which include slaves. So what the custom collector would do is he would resell everything. So you would go to auction, and so you could bid on the spices, you could bid on the gold, and you could also bid on the slaves. And so the government did not allow Jean Lafitte to go bid because Jean Lafitte brought the boat. So what would Jean Lafitte do? He would put a plant out there, a friend, a fellow slaver, some kid, somebody else would go out and bid on the slaves. They would buy the slaves and then they would take to Jean Lafitte. According to the United States government, that was now your property and you could do whatever you wanted to. So Jean Lafitte would sell the slaves again to planters and farmers. So Monroe grew up understanding this. And I believe he watched it, and I believe that he was very enamored with Jean Lafitte because at that point Jean Lafitte was a very admired and wealthy human trafficker. Now, you may remember, you may not know, but Jean Lafitte did come over to Galveston. He expanded his, if you live down in Houston where I live, you know about this story. But Jean Lafitte came over, and if you go to Galveston, you can go hear the story about Jean Lafitte. They have a whole museum about him. So Jean Lafitte moves over to Galveston. When he starts moving over to Galveston, that's why I think the abolitionists started thinking that Texas was going to become the next slave market, because they knew Jean Lafitte moved over there. Monroe does move over to Texas. He moves over to Texas after his family is finished with their work in Mexico for Stephen F. Austin, and they're now in Nacogdoches. So he comes over, I believe at that point, James Morgan shuts up shop in New Orleans. He moves over here too. He hires Monroe at this point to work with him on his very profitable, again, store. You know where this store is. It is called the Port of Houston. The Port of Houston, through years later, eventually built itself on top of the property where Morgan had his original store. So that's kind of the area that we're talking about here. Now, who are some of the other people that maybe Lafitte put out to bid for him? Well, the one in the middle is Samuel May Williams. If you ever go down to Galveston, you can see Samuel May Williams' home. It's an historic home. They spend a lot of money to keep that house good. It's a tourist attraction. Samuel May Williams was a slaver. Another one, if you ever went down to Houston and you drove down Houston, you may have run across a very long and prominent street called Fannin. It's named after James Fannin. He was a slaver, but we remember him instead as being massacred in Goliad in the run-up to the Alamo fight. So if you ever heard of the massacre at Goliad, he was the commander of that. It's a very gruesome story of what they did, but he was a slaver. Now, if you don't know who Jim Bowie is, then you're just not Texan. But I believe of all of these guys, Jim Bowie was probably the most likely to have been a bidder for Lafitte in the New Orleans auctions. Monroe knew all of these guys. He really knew Jim Bowie. Jim Bowie was born in Kentucky, and probably about a 2 to 3 day walk between Jim Bowie and the Monroe Edwards and his family in Kentucky at the time. So these guys go way back. So let's start with our story now. Did I skip something? No, I didn't. I didn't skip anything. Yeah, okay, that is the right slide. Okay, so one day in 1832, Morgan has sent Monroe down to Galveston Island to do some work for him. And while Monroe is down there, a friend of his from New Orleans, who's a slaver named Holcroft, comes up to him and says, "Hey, I've been looking for you. I want you to help me run slaves from Africa." He tells him that you can make a lot of money if you go straight to Africa rather than go into the Cuban slave market. So Monroe thinks about it, and Monroe says, "Okay, I'll do it." Now, one of the ways that you would circumvent the British Navy if you were a slaver on the high seas is you would take an alias, and that's what Holcroft is. Holcroft is an alias. I did a lot of research. I came very, very close to believing that I knew enough to actually name Holcroft as the by his real name, but I just didn't feel comfortable because there are a lot of people who go deep into this history like I have, and I didn't want to get into an argument with them over it, so I just called him Holcroft. Then, the other thing you would do is you would burn your ship after you came back from Africa. The reason you would burn your ship is because you would go get another ship, you would re-register it under the same name, and that would kind of start to confuse the British Navy because they didn't know if it was which Clara it was, which Clara it wasn't, which one was it. And so you were trying to confuse them. And the Clara was one of these ships. You could maybe call it a ghost ship. So if you're ever watching the Pirate of the Caribbean now, you have a whole nother appreciation for the dead pirates on the ghost ship. But this is kind of what you would call a ghost ship. Clara had many, many versions to her. So that's why he needed somebody like Monroe, because he needed to disguise the Clara. And he needed somebody smart enough to be able to keep the British Navy off his back. Holcroft did not run slaves, at least not on this run. He didn't run slaves to the United States. He ran them to South America. And he took orders. He had orders from the plantation farmers down there and the plantation owners on how many slaves they needed. And so he was looking for someone to help him disguise the Clara as an American ship run by an American captain. So, what did he actually ask Monroe to do? He asked Monroe to be a fly captain. Now, according to the laws at that time in 1832, the British Navy would go across, you know, up and down the coast of West Africa. But if you were not in a treaty with Britain at the time, they couldn't capture your ships. So that basically means that if your country was not part of the group that was trying to stop slaving along the West Africa coast, then they weren't going to mess with you. America did not have a treaty with Britain at this point. In fact, it was very, very rare to see an American ship along the West Africa coast during this point. It was so rare. It was even more rare for someone to be arrested on these ships because America was not sending ships to Africa at this point, okay? But it was still happening. It was happening enough that Holcroft knew that maybe he could get away with it. So Monroe was hired to be a fly captain. And this is what the fly captain did. The fly captain, let me back up and let me tell you about the flags. before I tell you about the flag captain, because there were two parts to this, this little thing they were doing. There were other ways also to circumvent the British Navy. Another way to do it was to go to Havana and go to the American consulate. And the American consulate at the time was very, very liberal with giving you an American flag, basically registering your ship as an American ship, even though it was from South America or someplace else. So I believe that Holcroft knew that Monroe was smart enough to go into the American consulate, pass himself off as an American captain, and get the Clara registered there. Okay? Now, why didn't Holcroft do all of this? I believe pretty much the story that Holcroft tells, which is that he was caught by the British Navy, and they knew exactly who he was. They knew his real name. I don't know it, but they knew it. And they knew what he did for a living. And he talks about after he got boarded, he jumped ship. So he lost his ship. And he ended up trying to find a new way to do this. So that's why he was going to go talk to Monroe. Holcroft's ship could have been, this is what the British Navy did with Holcroft's ship. In the 1830s, they realized that they weren't able to catch slave ships because they were big warships, right? They were the big warships. And these were little ships that kind of went really fast. So when they would catch a slave ship, they would recommission it and make it part of its fleet. So I believe that either Holcroft got caught by one of these ships or his ship became one. This right here is called the Black Joke. It is a slave ship that the British Navy caught, recommissioned, and sent it back out to catch slave ships. And this is actually a picture of the Black Joke in a battle with a real slave ship. Okay? Oh, by the way, to be the flag captain, Monroe also picked up an alias at this point. He called himself Captain Jones. So, the British did end up boarding the Clara, and this is what happened. They got on the ship. Holcroft went down into the ship, pretended to be the one of the hired hands, okay? Up at the top, they hoisted the flag. So now whenever you're watching these old pirate movies and you hear them calling, hoist the flag, that's what they're talking about. They're talking about taking down their real flag and putting up the American flag so that they look like they're a neutral or friendly ship. So they hoisted a new flag. Monroe comes out. He's nicely dressed. He's gorgeous. He's a very, very well-mannered man. He's impeccable. He's very much like a Jean Lafitte character. The British Navy comes on, they go down to his quarters, they look at his papers, they find out that he came from South America, they ask him all kinds of questions about Rio and other places like that. He tells them very nicely all the beautiful things about South America. They come back upstairs, they look at all the hatches, they kind of look at each other, they say, good morning, have a wonderful time, good luck to you, and they get off the ship. For that performance, Monroe was paid between $5,000 and $8,000 in 1832 money. So this is just another way to show you where we're talking about on the transatlantic slave route. The first one, the red line, is the line that we're talking about right now, the trip to Africa from South Africa, from South America. But later, he will use British banks that have fronts in Cuba to fund the blue line. And they will be bringing Cuban slaves to Cuba, and then they'll also be bringing them to Galveston for him. But you'll see on the site, Limboko, everything is coming straight out of Limboko. So this just gives you another perspective of what part of the transatlantic slave route we're going to be talking about. We're not going to be talking about London or anything like that. So what's Limboko? Limboko was not just a slave fortress. Limboko was a slave kingdom, a private slave kingdom. It started in 1814 with John Farber. John Farber created it in order to circumvent the British Navy. He later gives it to a guy named Pedro Blanco. Pedro Blanco was a Cuban who came to Limboko simply to give slaves to the Cuban market. Now, Limboko was in the Galenas, off the coast of Sierra Leone. It had a series of islands. There was one island that had storehouses. So any kinds of goods that came in was on one island. On another island, there was his office. On a third island, he kept his African wives. And on his fourth and fifth islands, he had little mini fortresses where he would bring the slaves in and put them there so that the ships that came in could just kind of stop, like a drive-through, if you will. You just come in, you get the slaves that you ordered from, and put them on your ship, and then you just keep on going, okay? He also had agents. He had agents all through Africa. He had them in about four or five regions. He also had a partner. His partner's name was Yano Cabarro. And Yano Cabarro worked out of Cuba. He also had agents in Trinidad, Puerto Rico, and when they met Monroe, they had an agent in the Republic of Texas. Now, the home for this slave fortress was not on the coast. It was about 300 miles inland. It was a palace. It was gorgeous when you walked up to it. And underneath, you had the dungeons, which is where the slaves would initially go. This fortress made a lot of money. This whole kingdom made a lot of money. Pedro was courted by banks in New York. He was courted by banks in London. They wanted him to invest money in their, they wanted his money. They wanted him to borrow money from them. They also wanted to extend him lines of credit. And Pedro did all of that. Now, how did his whole thing work? Well, John Farber had started a network with the African tribal chiefs, okay? And Pedro took that over. The most documented relationship he had with one of the chiefs was with the Mende tribe chief called King Shaka. King Shaka wanted, in exchange for bringing people to Pedro, he would get guns and ammo from London. Now, King Shaka would not just bring him other tribes, he would also bring his own tribe. So that was a lot of how the whole system worked. In the case of Monroe and Holcroft, they did not bring guns and ammo from London. They brought it straight off their ship. They brought what was called a superload. And their superload had muskets, powder, rum, cutlass, bar iron, and tobacco in it. After they were boarded by the British Navy, Holcroft and Monroe went straight towards Cape Palmas, which is where the Maryland abolitionists were trying to create a colony. They turned from there and they went northwest and they landed at Lomboco. When you landed at Lomboco, a tribe would come out to meet you. It was the Crew tribe. The Crew tribe, if the British Navy was nearby, would act like they were bringing you coconuts, water, bananas, saying hello to the weary travelers. They would kind of act like they were little tourist guides or welcoming committees. The British Navy was not there. The Crew tribe would do what they were hired to do. And for this, they got slave immunity. Now, in the 1830s, they had slave immunity, but later when I was doing my research, after Lomboco was blown up, I did see Crew tribes on slave records. But at this point, they have slave immunity. So they would help the slave ship. They helped Monroe get off the slave ship, get to shore. They did feed them, and then they took them 300 miles up into the jungle so that they could meet Pedro in his palace. So some of them stayed after they got up there, after they made it through the jungle, and then others went back to the slave ship to make sure that it was positioned to get the load. So they are up in the palace now. They stay there for 5 days. They choose 198 slaves. The slaves are brought back down through the jungle. They're put on the shipping island, and they leave. They paid $25 for each person. Now, during the time that Monroe was at Lomboco, it was the busiest time for the West African slave market. There were about a dozen slave markets that stretched from Limboko up to Cape Misurata. This is a picture of Gori Island, and it shows you kind of what these little islands look like where the ships would come up. There was so much activity at the time that sometimes when you came up to the islands, there were 65 ships ahead of you. This was very much like looking at the Houston Ship Channel, just packed with ships. The British Navy, now you can see why they started trying to catch them and recommissioning their little ships, because they were having a very, very hard time with this. They eventually caught 23 ships, and of that 23 ships, they had 1,000 slaves. The total number of slaves that came off of this section of Africa between 1824 and 1839 was between 80,000 and 100,000. Of the 1,000 slaves that they found, 48% of them were children and women. And of the 23 ships that they found, 3 were not going to Cuba. So this is actually Gori Island. You can go to it. It's like this. It's a UNESCO site now. And here at the bottom, you will see a slave fortress. This is a bare picture of it. During his administration as president, Obama went and visited Gori Island with Michelle. So the Middle Passage. We're not going to spend a lot of time on the Middle Passage, one, because it's very sad. The other part of it is that we would never get to where we need to go with this story. But it was a very, very hard, hard time. And by the time Monroe reaches South America with his ship, the Clara, he has lost 11 people. They have died through the Middle Passage. And one person has committed suicide, and Monroe did talk about it. He talks about a man who was clearly a prince of a chief. He was a prince. He was the son of a chief. He was big, muscular, very good-looking young man. Monroe describes him as someone who had manly sadness. And one day, he just got up, walked over to the plank, crossed his arms, fell over. And Monroe always remembered it, but he describes it very weird. He calls it a peculiar and strange incident, which leads me to believe that in some way he just really, it did not resonate with him like maybe the story resonates with us today. By the time he lands in Brazil, which is where they were going, he has 181 slaves now from the 198. They deliver the people to the plantation farmers. They get paid, and they promptly burn the Clara. At this point, Monroe splits $100,000 in 1832 money with Holcroft, and he is now the richest man in Texas. So, Monroe decides he wants to keep on slaving. So, how does he get funded? I'm going to tell you how funding worked in old Texas for slavery. In 1831, there was a man, his name was George Knight, and he was an American working for the Americans in Havana. And he visited the Baring Brothers in London. And this bank in London was very, very important. It did two things that you'll remember from your history. The first one is that it funded the United States for the Louisiana Purchase. The second thing that this bank did is it funded the Americans in the War of 1812. So George Knight wanted to talk to the Baring Brothers about new credit tools to help the merchants in Cuba who were in the slave market. It took him several years to do this, or a year or two to do this. But eventually, he talks the Baring Brothers into going head-to-head with the American banks in New York to do one thing, and that would be to invest in the South. That's code for investing in slavery and slave smuggling. The Baring Brothers did not want to be known as being a bank down in Havana, so they told George Knight, okay, I'll tell you what, you can go to Mariátegui, which was a company that they were already investing in. Mariátegui was moving sugar from Cuba to New York, and that was the route that they were investing in. So in Cuba, the bank became known as the Mariátegui, George Knight & Company. In Texas, it was just known as the George Knight Company, run by George Knight. And these guys did. They all got together and they decided that they were going to invest in slave smuggling. It was going to be one of their illicit ventures. And Monroe was one of the very first ones they invested in. They gave him $32,000, they gave him $35,000 to buy slaves, and they gave him $500 to buy a cannon, presumably for his friends who were getting ready to fight the Mexicans. This is a painting of the Baring Brothers. And they were members of what was basically known in Britain as the glory days of the British banks. They were also one of the banks that Pedro Blanco was investing in, and they were courting him. It took over 100 years for the Baring Brothers Bank, to collapse. It collapsed in the 1990s when it got hooked up in a very, very bad fraud scandal with the Chinese stock market. And a Dutch bank called ING bought it for a dollar. And then the bank ING, you may have heard about recently, because it is now one of the biggest global banking networks in the world. And when we had our latest global recession, they went to the European Union and said, we need help. And they said, okay, we'll help shore you up, but you're going to have to sell off part of your American unit. So they said, okay, we'll sell it. And they sold it to Capital One. And that was how the British banks and the European banks went from the slave market to credit cards. So, Monroe also had a partner. His partner was Christopher Dart. And Christopher Dart backed all of Monroe's loans with George Knight. And in December of 1835, they actually go to Havana. Now, they weren't always going to Havana together. Sometimes just Monroe went, sometimes just Christopher went, but at this time, they both went. They arrived with $50,000 in cash, so they got the $36,000 from the bank, and then they had their own money. They began buying slaves from Cuba for roughly $357 a person, and their total bill was $67,116. Monroe also bought the cannon. He bought a jolly boat, he bought gunpowder, balls, peas, grain, beans, bananas, and oranges. He did all that on credit, presumably to help everyone with the Texas Revolution. When they left Cuba, I don't think that Christopher Dart went with him. I think Christopher Dart probably went back to New Orleans where he was from. But Monroe goes on ahead, comes up to the Brazos River, the mouth of the Brazos River, and drops off about 183 slaves and puts them in a warehouse. A few weeks later, another ship comes. I guess, you know, it was also part of that load. Drops off another 50 slaves. So now Monroe has over 200 slaves on the Texas coast. Not all the slaves make it into a warehouse. This is a warehouse called the Chenango Plantation. It no longer exists, although it existed when I was researching my first book. It is now a little McMansion plantation down in the Brazos River region. But not all of his slaves made it to here. Some of them got lost. He lost 124 slaves during the Mexican advance in 1835. He had so many slaves lost that at one point, people would say that if you saw an African who didn't really have any clothes on, didn't really seem to understand what was going on, maybe was a little scared, it was probably one of Monroe's slaves. And that was basically common cultural mainstream knowledge at the time. The following year, in February of 1836, which is actually just a few weeks before the April siege, where the Mexican government comes through and we end up with the Alamo and everything else, the customs official of the Brazos River at the time, his name is William Fisher. And he watched a ship come up one night. It was the Shenandoah. The Shenandoah was run by the slavers Patrick and Sterling McNeil, and they were friends of Monroe. So the Shenandoah comes up, he watches it, he starts seeing some boats come out, and the boat goes around the mouth of the Brazos and doesn't stop and say anything. And he thinks that's very weird. So he gets out and he starts following the boat. He finds the boat, and the boat is empty. So he's like, that's really weird. So he gets out and he starts walking through the forest and everything, and he finds about 171 slaves. They clearly had gotten off the boat and taken off, and they were going to run for it. And I can't blame them. So this makes Fisher so mad. He writes to Stephen F. Austin and says, "You have got to do something about this. I am getting tired of it. This happens all the time. I expect some instruction from you and some resources." Clearly that never happened. And this is one of the reasons that, oh, and Fisher does go take the slaves and gives them to Monroe, and Monroe says, yes, they're mine. 2 years earlier, at the convention of 1833, which is a big moment in Texas history, there were several things that happened. One of them was that they censored Monroe because they knew Monroe was doing this. They knew Monroe was bringing slaves in from Cuba and Africa. So they censor him. They also call slavery an abhorrent thing that they would never, ever think about doing. And they also say that they're going to start putting up some more ships from the Texas Navy to patrol the coast of Texas. So they would be having like the British Navy over here, and Texas would be over here patrolling Texas. And from the story I just told you, it's very clear that they didn't do that. So who were these slaves? They were predominantly children. During this time, it was very popular for some people in Britain, they were called travelers, to come over to Texas and write stories about it. And one of those people is William Fairfax Gray. So if you are ever with an historian academic like Tom, and you throw out the name William Fairfax Gray, he will think you are very, very learned. William Fairfax Gray went to Monroe's slave warehouses. Monroe had one on the Galveston mainland in a place that you know today as Texas City. So if you ever go down to Galveston, right before you go over the causeway, the bridge to get you to Galveston, you're going to see off to your left a petrochemical industry. That's Texas City. And that was where Monroe had his first slave warehouse. The other one was in Chenango on the Brazos River. And William Fairfax Gray went to both of them, and he talks about four different groups of children that he saw. The first group were tall, slender, very delicate in feature, very pretty. He says they were very, very smart. They didn't speak English, French, or Spanish, but when you said something to them, they were very quick to try to talk back and have a conversation with you. There was another group that huddled together, and you could never talk to them. He described them as beastly, and they never wanted anything to do with anybody. There was another group, and the child had like a blanket. They had found a blanket or something to put over him, like a robe, and the children were deferring to him, and they were doing things for him. And Fairfax Gray is very upfront and says he believes 100% this was a child of royalty, and they were trying to replicate that culture here. Another time he saw them throw meat to the children to try to give them food, and the children just grabbed it and acted like they were wolves, just trying to eat it. And there was a grown black overseer, a black slave, with a whip, and he was popping them in order to keep them controlled. Why did Monroe want children? Well, Monroe wanted children and women because you got a bigger ROI on them. You got much more for your return on your investment. You had a child, you had a longer time to keep the child. If you couldn't sell the child early, you had a longer time to maybe sell them as they grew. A woman, you also wanted her because she could reproduce. So what happened to the children during the Revolution? The Texas Revolution in April of 1836, called the Siege of 1836, is also called the Runaway Scrape, which is when all of the settlers tried to leave Texas so that they wouldn't get caught up in the war that was about to happen. So there was a boat called the Flash. The Flash was owned by New York investors. New York investors were very interested in Texas for the reasons that I just told you about. And so James Morgan, the guy who owned the store that Monroe worked at when he first came over, went to them, and there were several kinds of investors. The customs official from New York port was one of the leaders, called Samuel Swartwath. There were Spanish people and Mexican people involved in this. There were other abolitionists involved in this. Don't get me started on that, that's a whole other presentation. But they were all investing in Texas. and they were investing in a port in order to bring goods in for the Texas rebels. And they bought this boat called the Flash. Monroe put about 50 to 80 children on this boat. He put so many children on this boat that prominent Texans could not get on during the runway scrape and leave Texas. They took the children down to Galveston and then on over to New Orleans. In another round, they took the children to Nacogdoches near the Sabine River. So he had about 200 slaves going up and down between Sabine and Galveston. The Flash was very impressive. Lots of Texans liked it. But it was actually one of the smallest boats to ever go into New Orleans. So it didn't really have a lot of room on it. But Monroe paid them, or actually said he would pay them, to move the children out during the April siege. So at the end of the Revolution, Monroe had about 200 slaves between Sabine and Bolivar in the Galveston area, okay? So after the Revolution, this was basically the way that Monroe handled his funds. I would describe it a lot like the construction industry today, where you have to have a lot of money up front, then you may be running some debt until some people pay you. So the best way to describe what Monroe was doing is that he was always rolling and leveraging debt with, in between that, very large moments of profit. Okay, that's the best way to talk about it. So when the Revolution was happening, he was not part of the Revolution. He was in New York talking to his partner, Dart, telling him, I will make you an equal partner. I will give you equal ownership in my slaves and in my property and in the slave smuggling operation. And Dart said he would do that, and he became the power of attorney. Now, Monroe also went down to Galveston and got a $500 loan from a bank called McKinney and Williams, presumably also a front for the Cuban government. And this is where I think that he actually took slaves from Africa in Galveston, because for $500, you cannot go to Cuba at the time and make any money off of that. But if the slaves were coming directly from Africa at $25 a pop, you might be able to make some money, right? So he does that. He tells everyone that he's going to, oh, and Dart also goes to George Knight and gets a $35,000 loan for him. And Monroe says he's going to make another Cuban slave run, and he's going to pay off all of his debts. He also says that he's going to take all of the 200 slaves from the Texas coast and bring them over to New Orleans, and he's going to sell all of them. Apparently he does all of that, and then he comes back, he buys Chenango, the slave warehouse that he was using, he buys it and flips it. And then he also buys another plantation, and he buys 622 acres on another Texas river. Why does he do that? I think two things are going on. He is either trying to shut down his slave smuggling network and move into investments like the New York guys were doing, or he was trying to set up enough land that he could expand his slave empire. Now, don't think that just because he was having trouble with his debt that that didn't mean he wasn't rich. This is how rich he was. At the time of the Revolution, he was worth $140,000 in 1836 money. You can see I have Chenango on there, but he had already flipped that. But you can still see he had a lot of property. To give you a comparison of how much richer he was than other slavers, people believe that Lafitte made about $65,000 during his slave smuggling in Texas. So you can see that's almost two, maybe almost, you know, more than twice what Lafitte made. He was clearly the most wealthy slave smuggler Texas ever saw. But you can see over on the side there, it wasn't without its problems. He had 18 lawsuits filed against Texas farmers and plantation owners. Why? Because Texas plantation owners oftentimes defaulted on their slaves, the cost of their slaves. So there were three ways you could buy a slave from Monroe. You could buy it, you could owner finance it, in other words, like a car, he would finance it, and you would pay him $16 a month until you paid off your slave. He would also barter. You could give him property, or you could give him another slave. He would take that. for payment. So you could buy, borrow, or barter. And that's how we did it in Old Texas. So, being the richest man in Texas with this slave empire was not enough for Monroe. When Dart took power of attorney, Monroe went to do what he really wanted to do. Monroe went over to England and started partying with all the aristocrats. He goes over with letters of induction from everybody from federal government down to Stephen F. Austin, anybody and everybody. And he would take these letters of introduction, he moves over there, he hands them out, and people love him because at the time, people thought people from Texas were barbaric. And instead, this beautiful, well-mannered man shows up with just the most loving attitude and just so charismatic. They had parties for him. He was the guest of honor at all kinds of things. He went to Queen Victoria's coronation. He had like parties for him at the Duke of Devonshire's house. He had an affair with a married woman that he met at the opera. He was having a great time until his family sends him a letter and says, "You need to get back over here. You have been sued by Christopher Dart." And so Monroe says, "Okay, I gotta go." They were so sad that he left because while he was there, he told them he was a Texas war hero. He basically appropriated William B. Travis's story and Sam Houston's story as his own. He said he was at the Battle of San Jacinto, and I told you where he was. He was making another deal to sell all of his slaves in New Orleans. He started calling himself Colonel, so everybody called him Colonel Monroe. And he comes back, they were very, very sad. So why did he have to come back and why was Dart suing him? Dart was suing him because of the Panic of 1837. So the Panic of 1837, this is what happened. Cotton and slave prices really shot through the roof between 1834 and 1837, during 3 years. And during that time, it created like a little bubble. So the British banks, the Barings brothers, they kind of look at their reserves and they go, "We're starting to lose our reserves because we've got this little bubble going on. But more importantly, we're investing head to head with the London banks and with the New York banks." So what basically ended up happening is they over-invested in America and over-invested in Texas. So they didn't have any reserves. So what did they do? They raised the interest rates. And when they raised the interest rates and it got back to the New York banks that they were raising the interest rates, the New York banks got very, very scared and they stopped lending. Does this sound very familiar to you? Because it's pretty much the same thing that kind of like happened in 2008. So they stopped lending. And when they stopped lending, the cotton commodities tanked. It took 8 weeks for it to tank, but it tanked. The other thing that tanked is the real estate market. The reason the real estate market tanked is because President Andrew Jackson, and I swear when I was doing this, I didn't know Trump was going to be president. When President Andrew Jackson thought the best way to stop inflation was to have a national bank. So he started the Second Bank of America. And in the Second Bank of America, you could go to the Second Bank and tell them that you wanted to buy property out west. And they would give you gold and silver to do that because you could buy it in gold and silver. So their reserves were going way, way low, okay? So when the New York bank stopped lending, it crashed the real estate market. And as a result of that, we went into a huge global recession. It lasted 10 years. Martin Van Buren, who was a Jacksonian, was president at the time that this happened, and he very much believed in the idea that you do not intervene and prop up banks. So he didn't do it, and that's basically what made everything crater for an entire decade. Monroe got caught up in this because George Knight and the Margariti Bank in Cuba called in their note, and Dart had to pay it. And he was furious. So, the trial ends Monroe's time as a slaver. I'm going to give you some backstory. The backstory to Monroe is this, and this is the one that Tom heard. Early in his life, Monroe learned how to create forgeries and swindles. He did it first as a teen in New Orleans. This may have been one of the reasons Holcroft wanted him involved in the slave run. But after the slave run, he figured out how to wash letters. And this is what you do when you wash letters. You take the letter, you put it in benzene. They had just discovered benzene at this point, but we always had bleach. So you put bleach and benzene together, you wash the letter, but you make sure you do not wash the signature. The reason you don't wash the signature is because we didn't have photographs, we didn't have driver's licenses, we didn't have social security numbers. People knew you by your signature. So you would wash the letter, everything that was on the letter, you would dry the letter, and you would now have a completely empty piece of paper with a signature on the bottom of it. You could write anything you wanted to up here now, and everyone would believe that the person's signature, it was from that person. The other thing that happened back in that time is paper. Paper was a really, really big deal. It's not like now where it's just go down to Office Depot, pick up a box. Paper was very important. People had paper for different types of things. They had it for private letters. They had it for official correspondence. They had it for finances. They had different types of paper for different things. Monroe essentially washed one of Dart's private letters to him. After he washed the letter, he wrote a bill of sale for Chenango. Now, just to remind you, when he did that, he did not own Chenango. He had flipped the slave warehouse to another person at that time. So he basically gave Dart, or he created a forged document. This was found out in the middle of the trial. The judge arrested Monroe for forgery, and then they went to San Antonio for bail. I know that sounds very, very strange, but you used to get on a horse back then and go visit another judge who would give you bail. And when you were in Brazoria, you would go to San Antonio. So on the road to San Antonio, Monroe knows that he has done more than just wash a letter. So he sends his slave back and tells his slave, go find out what everybody in town knows. The slave does that. The slave comes back and says, not only do they know that you washed the letter, they also know that you created very elaborate swindles to confuse everybody on what was going on. And at that point, Monroe does the only thing he can do. He gets on his horse with his slave, and he leaves Texas never to return. So Texas's love for Monroe starts to go downtown really quick. The courts begin closing in on him. Dart basically spends the rest of his life getting judgments against Monroe. George Knight liquidates the bank and calls in another one of his outstanding loans. The New York investors that were involved with the flash start telling everybody in New York, be wary of this guy. Some held out hope that maybe he might turn his life around, but eventually, no one has a good word to say about him. Now, where was Monroe during all this time? Monroe was in Ohio with his slave, who was a girl named Kitty, who used to dress up as a boy called Henry. I'll let that sink in for a while. That's a whole nother story. Kitty was a slave girl who dressed up as a boy who called himself Henry. And while Monroe was in Ohio with Kitty, he met a plantation farmer that he used to know back in the day. The plantation farmer introduces him to this whole group of people called the abolitionists. And he begins going to their meetings, he begins reading their materials, he begins talking to all of them, he's absorbing everything he possibly can about them, and he decides that he needs money to free all of his slaves, including his slave girl named Kitty, who dresses up as a boy who calls herself Henry. And so he gets so wrapped up in this, he puts an advertisement out and says he is now an abolitionist and he needs help freeing his slaves. But was he really an abolitionist, though? And that's the rest of the story. And thank you for letting me tell you about his trip to Limboko.
Really interesting story, and really glad to hear of it. Have not heard anything like this from Texas before history. But how do the slaves, were they employed in Texas?
They were down in the, yes, yeah, I understand what you're saying. Yeah, they were, I agree with you. I grew up here in Fort Worth, and I was never taught this story. I was never taught, I mean, I knew there were slaves in Texas, but it was just kind of glossed over, and we spent a whole lot more time on the Chisholm Trail and other, you know, Shawnee Trail and all of that. We spent a lot more time on the cattle, I guess you could say. But yes, down in Houston, in Galveston, and then going over to what you would know as Fort Bend County, we had an entire plantation economy, and we had many, many plantations. One of them still exists in Lake Jackson, and I was also going to tell you that Chenango, when I was doing research on my first book, I was told to go out to Chenango and I would still see the sugar mill, and I went out there and I didn't find it. What it basically happened is it had been there for so long, and they sold that property to a private developer who created what you would call McMansions out there, and they just demolished the last of that plantation. They have another plantation, the Werner Hogg Plantation, that they still keep up. That's the state keeps that up, and it's down there also in that area. So they were working more sugar than cotton. Originally, when Stephen F. Austin landed in Texas, they had cane growing wild down there, so he knew that they could have a sugar plantation here. But that's not what they did initially. Initially, what they did is they just cultivated the land and grew crops. They grew potatoes and carrots and all of that. And then they had the sugar plantation. And you might remember Texas as being the sugar bowl. Okay, that's where that comes from. They did also have cotton after that, but cotton came after sugar.
From what I understand, the sugar plantations were more brutal than the cotton fields.
Yes. I don't know how many of you have been keeping up with what's been going on down in Fort Bend right now, but after we got done with slavery because of the Civil War, we began the prison labor market. And probably in the last 6 to 8 months, we have been dealing with the fact that they found people prison. They found a mass grave. That's the only way I can say it. They have a mass grave of people who were buried from the sugar plantations. And Fort Bend schools are thinking about building over it instead of preserving it. So it's a huge issue right now. I have friends that are wrapped up in trying to make something of that site, but it looks likely that the school is just going to build over it.
Questions, comments?
That's just another narrative to our continuing struggle with slavery.
You said that the majority of the slaves came from Africa.
Yeah.
And Cuba.
Yeah, they came from Africa to go to Cuba.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, to go to Cuba. Okay, then I just wondered about that. I wanted to make sure I got that straight.
Yeah.
And all the things you talked about today, are they book?
Yes, they are. They're in two chapters that most people don't ever want me to talk about. This is the first time I've ever talked about this part of the book. I think this is probably one of the most important parts of the book. It took me a very long time to piece this together, and it was very emotional for me.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
But Tom was the first person who ever said, can you put something together about that part of the book? Most people just want to hear the cool part about it, because he's washing letters and stuff like that.
Any other questions? No, I have a few questions. Comments, protests? Can you give a genealogical resource? I know a couple of people here are interested in their own genealogy. Were you able to locate descendants of any of these slaves?
Oh, not the slaves, but I'll tell you something else that was in the book that I didn't talk about at the State Fair. The reason I think Monroe had Kitty was because his grandfather, who was a decorated American Revolutionary and was actually part of the people who started the state of Kentucky, abandoned his entire family for his slave mistress. And they went across the Mason-Dixon line. They had a completely completely new family. And then he dies. And when he dies, both families knew about each other because the family in Kentucky, Monroe's aunts and uncles, went to help the mistress take care of the body and everything. And so when I was trying to figure out and piece together Monroe's genealogy, I was not able to do that through Ancestry.com. I did it all through Black Genealogy. The Black Genealogy had the complete records. They had the will. They had everything. So that was one. That's something I think is very important for people to know. As far as when I mentioned about the fact of the cruise, I got all that from slave records, because if you go through them, you can see that what tribes they were coming from.
Would you say that most of the, it sounds to me like most of the Texas slave trade, the slaves were from West Africa?
Yes. Yes, they were. They came through Cuba. In 1837, there was a gradual release program going on in Cuba for a while. And in 1837, they started doing this apprentice thing where you were released. And that was where you would start hearing stories about when Cuban apprenticed workers were coming over. They were being beaten and told that, no, you're not going to be released after 3 years of working for your plantation owner. You're now going to sign this document that says that you will be indentured to him for 99 years, essentially the rest of your life. And so we were doing that too. But that was not part of the story, so I don't have that part in the book.
Yes, sir.
So what makes Texas slavery unique then as compared to the rest of the slavery which happened on the East Coast?
Oh, you're talking about the East Coast of like Mississippi and Missouri? Oh, okay, yeah. So the Old South, quote unquote, Old South, yeah. Actually, Monroe worked over there too. So if you look, let me see if I can get back there. I don't know how long it's going to take me to get back there, but how can I get to the... Maybe that would work. Nope, that's not going to work. So if you saw that, remember that first slide that I put up that showed the slave smuggling went straight into Galveston? It also showed you where the slave smuggling network was going in the other parts of the old South, you know, of Mississippi and Louisiana. It was going into New Orleans. It was going into Mobile, Alabama. Oh, they put it up. Thanks, guys. Are you trying to find it for me? You're doing that. Okay. Very much to the front, the very, very front, probably the fourth slide. And so you can see that they were doing that there. So in a lot of ways, it wasn't any different. In my mind, I figured that probably, yeah, right, no, back. Keep going, the prettier one. I believe that there were probably other kinds of Monroe Edwardses in that area. Keep going. You guys, one more. There you go, right there. That's the slave smuggling network. So New Orleans, Mobile, Savannah, that's what it's, Savannah, Charleston, and Amelia Island in Florida.
So conceivably, you could have families, same family, one going to Savannah and another brother going to Galveston.
Yes, you absolutely could. Because if you remember, Tom, I was talking about the fact that they didn't choose slaves at Lomboco based upon family relations. They were just picking them. So you're absolutely right. It's unconscionable today.
I want to know about Jane Long in Lafitte. You know, she was on, and she fell in love with Ben Milam. And then I have another family in Hempstead that I'm half related to a little bit, but they're all dead now. Ferguson, wasn't he a governor of Texas?
Yes.
Okay, then there's a Mr. Wood, and he was associated with Ferguson, and there's a big plantation there, which I went on, and when I was little, it was just wonderful. I got to eat with all of everybody. I got to go visit them in their cabins, and none of them left. When slavery was over, the slaves refused to leave, and they all stayed. And eventually, in 50 years, they moved to Houston, some of them moved to Houston, and they became heroes taking care of volunteer work, taking care of white people. Oh, it's just fantastic.
Are you talking about Ferguson's plantation or Mr. Wood's plantation?
Mr. Wood's plantation is the one I was on, but he was associated with Ferguson. I don't know how.
Yeah, I don't know how either.
I don't know when this was chronologically or anything.
Yeah.
But I'm real interested in Jane Long, uh-huh. and They went back to Richardson, didn't they?
Oh, Jane Long is a whole nother story on her own. Jane Long, for yes, she was involved with Lafitte, yeah. Her husband was Autry Long, who was a pirate with Jean Lafitte, and when Jean Lafitte came over to Galveston, he kicked Autry Long off, and Jane Long was really mad about it. I can't remember which book I have that in. I don't know if I have it in the first book or the second book. But yeah, I had to do a lot of, and there are a lot of people that want me to do a story about Jane Long. Jane Long is a crusty old Texas dame. That's the only way to put it. And
she's being polite.
And she was out in Nacogdoches. And in fact, when Monroe's family came back from Mexico, they took that property that she was squatting on. And it becomes, and because of the fight that they have with Jane Long, and that is in the book, the fight that they have with Jane Long and the squatters turns into the Fredonian Rebellion. And I believe that's when Monroe came over from New York. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
She says she had the first kid in Texas. I don't know if that's true or not. Some people fight. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
In what sense, ma'am, is the book a counterfeit, or Mr. Edwards counterfeit?
I'm sorry, say that again?
In what sense is he counterfeit?
Oh, is he a counterfeit prince? Because the slavery part makes him so wealthy, and that's what sets him on this international crime spree. When he leaves Texas and goes to Ohio, he gets wrapped up with some of the people who were defending the slaves on the Amistad. And after that, he ends up going over to England. He swindles Princess Diana's ancestor, the Earl Spencer III. He swindles the first investment bank in New York. He ends up becoming a very, very bad criminal. He's kind of like a Bernie Madoff,
One of the, we struggled when we were talking about how much time, you know, we had, and I said about 45 minutes to an hour, and it's already, what, 4:30?
Oh, is it? Oh, my God.
What time is it? Anyways, we struggled because I felt like this is the first and most documented and thorough investigation of Texas and slavery ever. And even though on another level, the counterfeiting story, mm-hmm. she could have talked about that for another hour and 15 mm-hmm. minutes as well. Mm-hmm. And I said, no, I'd rather hear about mm-hmm. Texas and slavery. Now, the counterfeiting story, if you like these, watch these crime shows.
Oh, yes.
That this story is way head and shoulders above those stories. Mm-hmm. He created some of the biggest capers I've ever heard.
Yeah.
Now, in terms of keeping people on the edge of their chair, that would have been probably a more, you know, as far as entertainment, a better story. But I was more interested in getting to, even though it's a sad part of history, I was more interested in her presenting that chapter because it's never been presented before.
No, nobody ever asks me about that. I give a lot of talks about this book, and they all want to hear the cool counterfeit part of it and the stories about the fun that he had in England and all of that. So I've totally skip over most of the slavery part, and I often get very upset about that because I feel like that's the most important part of the book. So I'm always glad to be able to present. This is the first time I put this together, and I hope I get to tell it again to other people. I'm going to start telling people I have this presentation now.
The bottom line, he knew how to forge, which was very unusual in those days. You had to be knowledgeable, and you had to have some knowledge of science. Mm-hmm. And he was a very good-looking man. And this is why people say, well, he was such a nice man, he was so good-looking. What does that have to do, you know, the Bernie Burnoff would get these people who were elegant-looking, and they think, well, he's such a nice man. Niceness has nothing to do with it. Looks have nothing to do with it. This man pulled off capers that I would have to spend the rest of my life figuring out how to pull these off. He pulled them off in minutes.
Yes. Yeah, he did. He did. It was kind of crazy. And he had a lot of people involved with it. Yeah. If you see the show White Collar on Netflix, I kind of think of him like that. He does a lot more with art and stuff like that. But that kind of a character is who Monroe was. And what's very interesting, since we're talking about genealogy and everything, after I wrote my book, I got a DM on Facebook, and it was from a descendant of one of Monroe's uncles. And she was absolutely astonished to find out that somebody had found out about Monroe, because her father always said there's a scoundrel somewhere. So now we're friends. We're friends on Facebook. She's out in Odessa.
Hold on. There's a question over here. Let me bring in that microphone. And this is for our television audience. This Q&A sessions are some of their best time. They get the they love our question and answer session.
I think we had another question over there. I'm not sure.
Did he ever have a family himself?
Oh.
And I have been sick ever since you said that he took slaves into Brazil. Because
yes.
I have heard that they were the cruelest
yes.
of masters.
They were.
Could be.
They were. I don't have that in the book, but I spent a lot of time researching down there. And I was, it was the last place to actually end slavery. It ended slavery after we had our Civil War. And it was those few weeks were very emotional for me.
When the slave trade, when they came up from West Africa, some went to, as I recall, they went to Cuba because they had to change flags. Is that correct?
Yes. Now you're starting to figure out why I was talking so much about the dual flags and all that. Yes. You're absolutely
You want
right.
to just kind of elaborate on that, because that's an important part of the story.
Okay. So the way I started that research was because I had to find out what a flag captain was. Because Monroe gave lots of interviews. And Monroe did say that he was a flag captain. And so that was when I started figuring out the different ways that you could circumvent the British Navy. And just to recap, without going into too much detail on it, but I do go into it into the book, I had to get some very deep historians and academics in the maritime industry to figure this out. But if you wanted to, you could go to Cuba. And the American consul, even though they didn't have a treaty with the British Navy to stop slavery, they were actually doing completely the opposite. By the time slavery hit us in the Civil War, almost every single flag along the Western African coast was flying an American flag. So you went to the consul, you told them that you needed to register your boat, they would register it, even though maybe it was registered in South America already, they would give you the flag. And then you could go and pretend to have a flag captain, which is the story that I told you about. Eventually, President Van Buren does not like this. He thinks this is an awful thing to do, so he actually introduces legislation to stop the American consuls from giving out what they called the dual flag. And this is the interesting part. The legislature didn't support him, and it failed. So by the time we really get into the 1839, 40s, around that area, almost every single flag that you see on the African coast is an American ship that really belongs probably to South America or somewhere else. Mm-hmm. So that just gives you an idea when people talk about institutionalized racism, that just gives you an idea of where maybe their thought process is coming from.
Any other questions, comments, or protest? You have heard a presentation today that's never been presented before, ever.
Thank you.